Bibliophiles of the internet, today I'm here to share my July wrap-up. As expected, July was a much more modest month compared to the past few months when I was on my recovery hiatus, but I'm still super happy with what I read this past month, a lot of really great books, so let's just jump right in. I'm actually gonna lump the first two together because they're both in the same series, so I finished out the last Binding trilogy with A Restless Truth and my Arc of a Power Unbound by Freya Marski, the latter of which comes out on November 7th from Tor.com. These are the two sequels to A Marvelous Light. It's a queer historical romantasy trilogy that begins when a non-magical human named Robin finds himself appointed to this highly secret office where he's meant to serve as liaison to this hidden magical society, and then he's mistakenly cursed and roped into this epic magical quest. A Restless Truth is the sequel slash companion continuing that quest, and it follows Robin's sister, Maud. It was pitched as magical sapphic knives out on a ship, which it pretty much is. And I also can't say much about the third book because it's the big finale, but it follows Lord Hawthorne, who makes appearances in the first two books, as he tries to put a stop to this dangerous magical ritual that threatens to completely dispel magic. And he's also falling for this cheeky writer slash thief named Alan Ross. Content warnings for A Restless Truth include death, physical assault, some descriptions of magic-related torture, and some explicit sexual content. Content warnings for A Power Unbound include sibling death, parental death, and grief, blood, violence, and graphic injury, some descriptions of chronic pain, some allusions to rape, mentions of suicide, some experienced racism, and explicit sexual content. It's also worth noting that every romantic pairing in this trilogy contains at least one bi person, which is great, and also Lord Hawthorne in the third book is disabled, uses a mobility aid, and experiences chronic pain. Starting with A Restless Truth, I enjoyed this. I love the concept of a maritime murder mystery, and I think the story did a great job of playing within that construct in really compelling ways. Especially because a ship has extremely defined parameters, you would think it would feel limiting, but somehow it doesn't. It has that feeling of a locked room mystery because there's only so many possibilities in this closed environment, but surprisingly, there's still ample opportunity to string out the suspense. So plot-wise, I just enjoyed this overall. It's part magical quest, part murder mystery, part romance. These books, by the way, are all so much steamier than you would think at first glance, which I do appreciate. I do enjoy a sexy queer romance. That said, one of my hang-ups with the first two books in that regard is that the sex scenes don't entirely feel related to the overall plot. They're kind of used as a break between plot points, which ends up making them feel somewhat disjointed or random, in my opinion. I also have to admit that Maud and Violet are my least favorite couple out of all three couples in this trilogy, and I think that's because they just have such strongly opposing personalities and values. To be clear, all the relationships in this trilogy have an enemies to lovers, or at least reluctant allies to lovers kind of dynamic, so while I understand the physical attraction, it was hard for me to make sense of the emotional attraction, if that makes sense. But what also makes it weird is that I didn't feel connected to these two in this book, but in the third book, when all the characters are together and we see Maud and Violet deeply involved in that story, but not as POV characters, then I felt much more for their relationship, which is strange. So overall, I gave this one a solid 3.5 stars. A Power Unbound, on the other hand, is my favorite book in this trilogy by a landslide. It is not even close. This book blew the other two out of the water, in my opinion. I think there's a lot of reasons for that. Primarily, this is the big finale. This is what everything's been leading up to. The payoff is there. It's a very exciting conclusion. Also, there's an extremely strong element of found family in this last book because all the characters and all the couples from the books before are coming together to complete this quest and to save the magical world, and it's just a joy to see so much love and friendship being shared between all of these characters. I also just appreciate what this book is doing thematically, and again, to the series' credit, that is something that's been building up over all three books. It's exploring who deserves power, how do we decide who gets to have power, and how much should we get to decide in the first place, and is there a way to use power responsibly when we do have that access? Something interesting about all three books is that they always center at least one POV character who doesn't have magic, who knows nothing about this society or this world, but is still undeniably affected by it. And I like how the series gives those characters prominence, importance, and value, and shows how even though they don't have magic, they can still discover their own power within their own right. Also, side note, this book is like way kinkier than the first two, and I deeply respect it for that. There's just so many things in this third book that are absolutely up my alley. There's a weird puzzle box house where the rooms move around and contain magical secrets. There's a heist plotline. There's found family. Like I said, there's a great romance. I just really enjoyed this, and reading it actually made me think if I were to reread the first two books in the future, I would enjoy them even more after having read this. I don't think it's a perfect trilogy by any means. Some parts of the magic system are definitely questionable, but I'm glad that I read it just to get to this book. I gave this 4.5 stars. After that, I read a middle grade fantasy called The Demon Sword Asperities by Sarah Jean Horwitz, and I was kindly gifted a finished copy by Algonquin Young Readers as part of an Instagram campaign. This is a super fun fantasy adventure. It's pitched as being for fans of Diana Wynne Jones and Terry Pratchett, which I think definitely rings true. It's about this newly retired demon sword, Asperities, who's grown weary of tricking humans into wielding him for the price of their souls. But one day he realizes that someone is attempting to resurrect his last wielder, who was an incredibly evil sorcerer, so that would not be great. So he's reluctantly drawn back into the action, searching for a new wielder who will help him vanquish this tyrant. He eventually comes across Nack, this young wannabe knight who's been exiled from his family and is desperate to prove himself. But first, he needs a sword and a quest. So Asperides is tempted to trick this one last human into enlisting his service so that maybe they can both get what they want. Content warnings for some thematic violence, instances of bullying, explorations of family estrangement, and references to war-related trauma. I thought this was such a fun twist on a classic knight's tale. It's quirky, it's exciting, it's adventurous, it's unique, but it's also full of heart. You know I love a good story that centers a ragtag group of heroes, and this book has a great cast consisting of a wannabe knight, a retired demon sword, a dejected moon prophet, a possibly reformed mistress of evil, and two heroic knights who happen to be wives. In that way, the story is definitely defying all the conventions when it comes to the question of who is allowed to be the hero. It's a very unlikely group of characters, but they are unwavering in this fight for justice. Interestingly, I think there's some great parallels between Nack and Asperides because they're both trying to prove themselves worthy of greatness, but because Nack is very heroic and Asperides is evil by nature, they have wildly different approaches and even understandings of what greatness means and how far they're willing to go to obtain it. So I like the sort of moral quandary that this story presents. Can someone who's good work with someone who's evil? Can two morally opposed people have the same goals? Can we go against our quote-unquote nature, the very things we were created or taught to do, in service of something greater than ourselves? The story is also challenging and complicating the moral makeups of the main characters. Is Nack truly heroic if he sells his soul to a demon sword and willingly looks the other way just to obtain power? Is Asperides truly evil if he starts off having selfish motivations but ultimately is working towards saving the world? The relationship between these two characters is changing both of them as the story goes on, revealing them to be much more complicated than they seem to be at the beginning, and again showing that a hero can look like so many different things. Again, I think this is an utterly hilarious, zany, original, bold, new fairy tale type of story. I had a great time reading it and I gave it 4.5 stars. Then I read my arc of Kiss the Girl by Zoraida Cordova, which was kindly sent to me by the author herself and recently came out on August 1st. This is the third book in the Meant to Be series, which are all standalone adult fiction retellings of classic Disney stories. As I'm sure you can guess, this one is an adult contemporary romance retelling The Little Mermaid, wherein Ariel is in this famous girl group called Siren 7, and even though they just wrap their epic farewell tour, her father wants her to start working on a breakout solo career ASAP. The night before that big announcement, Ariel sneaks out to go see a rock concert for this up-and-coming indie band and crosses paths with the dreamy lead singer, Eric Reyes, who doesn't recognize her and invites her to join him and his band on the road for the summer as they tour and try to catch their big break. Content warnings for parental estrangement, manipulative and emotionally abusive parenting, mentions of death and grief, and some fade-to-black sexual content. Also worth noting that this is a Latina romance. Ariel's family is Ecuadorian and Eric is from Colombia. I enjoyed this a lot. I think it's such a creative retelling, and in some ways, with the story being a strictly contemporary retelling, you would think that might pose a narrative narrative challenge in a story where magic plays a pretty important part, but I think that actually opens the door for so many new and interesting possibilities. What I enjoyed most about this retelling is that it gives Ariel and Eric so much time to bond and get to know each other and fall in love. And even though these two characters do experience an instant attraction, it's really a slow burn romance with a lot of push and pull, will they, won't they type of dynamics. So it was really fun to see how Zoraida would bring up these iconic plot points in the story in completely new and surprising ways. And because she really gave the relationship time to blossom, it makes those romantic beats much more satisfying to read. I also love that this story really makes a meal out of this summer rock tour. There's so many opportunities for romantic shenanigans there, like the only one bed trope, the forced proximity trope, and the story really makes the most out of all of those moments. And again, even though there's no magic in this story, I really appreciate the interpretation of Ariel becoming part of Eric's world because she's joining him on this tour. She's discovering new things about herself now that she's anonymous and no longer in the spotlight. She has this bucket list of ordinary things she's always wanted to do that they're slowly checking off together across all these different tour stops. Like, all of it is just cute. And it's also exploring questions about the burden of familial obligation, what it means to live for yourself, how difficult it is to discover who you are when so much of yourself is tied up in other people, and what it means to choose something with both eyes open, so to speak. I do think some of the side characters, especially Ariel's father, can fall a bit flat sometimes, and you definitely have to dispel a lot of belief in certain parts of the story, but like I said, it's a great retelling that touches on all the hallmarks of the original while still being completely new and surprising and fulfilling. I had a really great time reading this, and I gave it 4 stars. After that, I picked up my e-arc of Vampires of El Norte by Isabel Cañas, which comes out from Berkeley on August 29th. Much like Isabel's first book, this is a blend of historical romance and supernatural horror. I think it also has aspects of the gothic and western genres as well. It's basically about vampires and vaqueros facing off at the Texas-Mexico border in the 1840s. The story follows Nena, who's the daughter of a powerful rancher and also a curandera, and her childhood sweetheart, Nestor, whose family's always worked that land for generations as vaqueros. When they're children and they're out for this forbidden nighttime stroll, Nena is actually attacked by a mysterious creature, and thinking that this attack has killed the girl he loves, Nestor runs away and is consumed by his guilt for years. But to both of their surprise, they're brought together once again when the United States begins attacking Mexico. Nena is acting as a curandera to heal the Mexican soldiers, and Nestor is a member of the auxiliary cavalry of vaqueros who are called to fight. And they quickly realize that humans may not be the only monsters they're up against. Content warnings for blood, death, graphic injury, and graphic violence, references to past infidelity, some instances of vomit, animal death, experienced colorism, and colonization, as well as some fade to black sexual content. Isabel Cañas is absolutely solidifying herself as a favorite author. Her debut, The Hacienda, practically rewrote my genetic material and was absolutely everything I needed in life. And while this is a very different kind of horror story in comparison, it did not disappoint. To set your expectations where they should be, I would say that this book is much more romance forward. It has those elements of gothic horror and the supernatural that help to drive home the thematic overtones, but the relationship between these two characters is really the heart of the story in every possible way. And honestly, I wouldn't change a thing about that focus. The connection between Nena and Nestor is magnetic. It is undeniable, it is palpable, it is tangible, it is achingly delicious. In my opinion, Isabel Cañas does romantic melodrama like no one else. She knows how to take the quietest and most innocuous of moments and layer them with all this romantic meaning and subtext and longing, and especially with how the threat of danger and death constantly looms over the characters, I think that only helps to throw the romance into sharp relief. It really heightens those romantic stakes. I wrote a note in my ebook that says, how does she make setting a dislocated bone sexy? And I don't have an answer. I don't know how she does it, but she does. So the romance is absolutely peak. I'm a sucker for a good second chance childhood friends to lovers romance, especially when one party, quote unquote, comes back from the dead. I think that's the ultimate second chance, and Isabel Cañas plays all of that angst and conflict and growth with so much finesse. Thematically, this story is super strong as well. The parallel between the vampires and the invaders is especially effective because they're both these monstrous forces that are draining Mexico's people and land of their life, their vitality, their freedom, and their resources. So it's almost like a war happening on all sides, and eventually there's a blurring of lines between the supernatural and the human when the characters begin to question whether those two enemies are separate threats or actually one and the same. What's more, there's a great exploration of the tension between the need for individuality and the obligation we feel towards serving our communities or our families as well. I just love how everything in this story pieces together so seamlessly. I don't think you would expect horror and romance and rugged Western aesthetics to go together, but they really do in the right hands. Actually, I wouldn't have minded if this story was a bit darker. I think there was room for more of those creepy, unsettling moments, and I know Isabel has that in her, but I still thought this was fantastic as is. I gave it 4.5 stars. Then I finally got to listen to Belladonna by Adeline Grace, and I checked out the audiobook from my library, which was read by Kristen Atherton. This is a historical, gothic mystery and romance. It's about Signa Faro, who's been followed by death her entire life, both metaphorically and literally, because she's left behind a string of deceased guardians, but also she can see and interact with death himself. Her only remaining relatives are the Hawthorns, a very eccentric, wealthy family. They're mourning the loss of their matriarch and also worried that the youngest daughter of the family might be suffering from the same mysterious illness. Being able to pierce the veil between life and death, Signa is contacted by the mother's spirit, who claims that she was actually poisoned. So if Signa wants to save her cousin's life, she will have to track down the killer before they can strike again, and she might just have to make an alliance with death himself to crack the case. Content warnings for death and grief, blood, injury, vomit, and violence, some mild body horror, references to past abuse, descriptions of terminal illness, and some sexual content. Before I forget to say it, I think the audiobook is the way to go with this one if you're able to access it, because it is quite the performance. I've said this before, but I personally never start reading a book in bad faith. I always have an inkling that a book is going to be interesting to me or meaningful to me in some way, and I also had one of my best friends who also doesn't read this type of YA fantasy often strongly recommend this to me, and still, I was very pleasantly surprised. First of all, I know I just called this YA fantasy, but really it's upper YA fantasy, if anything. If the category of new adult had ever taken off the way it should, this would very comfortably fit into the new adult fantasy space. And I'm not saying that to position it above YA fantasy in terms of like literary merit, but rather to help you set the correct expectations. Anyways, I was so into this. I love a genre blend, and this book is so many things at once. It's a historical romance and coming of age, it's gothic horror, it's paranormal, it's a murder mystery, and even though you might not think to put all those things together, it works. Signa is such a fascinating character because all the different parts of herself are almost diametrically opposed. On the one hand, she's this wealthy, highborn, proper young lady who just wants to comport herself in high society with grace and ease. That's how she wants to be seen by her peers. But then she has this secret other life where she literally communes with death and discovers that this connection between them might mean that they share some of the same powers, which is metal as fuck and so badass. So that's what makes the mystery in this story so incredibly dynamic. There's almost like two layers to this investigation. There's what Signa and her companions can find by day through the quote-unquote proper channels, and then there's things that can only be discovered under the cover of night or with the help of death and his dark reaper magic. And that ties in really beautifully with Signa's coming-of-age arc because she's realizing that these two parts of herself are very deeply locked in conflict. Can she be this proper young lady whose highest aspiration in life is to find a good marriage and make sure she never draws too much attention to herself, and also be someone who understands the power and the workings of death, someone who knows what it's like to exist beyond the confines of mortal limitations? That's ultimately why I connected to the story so much, because it's about Signa learning to embrace who she really is. It's about her learning that she can't be afraid of her true nature, learning that power, no matter where it comes from, can always be used for good in the right hands, and that she is so much stronger and so much more powerful when she stops holding herself back for other people's sake. That's what the story is about. It's about a character saying, I am not going to be afraid to walk my own path, even if it doesn't make sense to anyone else, even if it doesn't line up with what I've been taught about the world and myself. I will not stray from the truth of who I am for the sake of anyone else's comfort. I didn't even get to talk about the romance yet. It is surprising and satisfying and dark in so many ways, but never in a way that's like over the top. I sent this meme to my friend who recommended this to me that said, none of these thoughts are in the Bible, which is very much the vibe of this romance, and it's my favorite romantic dynamic. Suffice to say, I was fully invested from start to finish. The audiobook was sensational. I immediately pre-ordered the sequel as soon as I read the last page, which I think says everything you need to know. I gave this a very strong 4.5 stars. And finally, the last book I started and finished in July, keywords, was The Mountain in the Sea by Ray Naylor. I also got this audiobook from my library, and it was read by Eunice Wong. This is a mind-melding, existential, sci-fi, eco-thriller about the discovery of this highly sentient octopus species that has developed its own culture and language, which is highly unprecedented, to say the least. And there's this megatech corporation known as Dianema who sealed off the Kondau Archipelago where the species lives. So the story's following a marine biologist named Dr. Ha, who's enlisted to come study these octopus because they could hold the key to untold intellectual breakthroughs. But of course, Dianema are not the only ones who want to take advantage of this incredible discovery, and they get drawn into this high-stakes race to be the first to establish contact with this species. Content warnings for some references to human trafficking and slavery, death, injury, and graphic violence, allusions to animal death, references to self-harm and suicide attempts, and some allusions to sexual content. This is a melt-your-brain kind of book. I don't want to call it big brain because I think that would make it seem intimidating, which I don't think it is. I think it's deeply fascinating, but rather it makes you as the reader feel big brain because you can feel your mind like unhooking and expanding exponentially as you read this. If you're someone who loves when a story really puts the science in science fiction, when it really grounds its speculative elements in scientific fact and theory, then this book is for you. It's like if Ted Chiang's Arrival and Planet Earth had a baby. That's what this is. And I think it's so incredibly clever to center the story around highly sentient octopi because it feels like a first contact story. It feels like an alien invasion, except humans are the ones invading this species' habitat and the call is coming from inside the house. The alien species in question isn't coming from without in outer space, but rather is living among us. And the reason it's so smart is because the octopus is the closest approximation to alien life that we already have, because they're entirely unlike any other species in the ways they function and exist. So even though it's speculative, it doesn't feel like it's out of the realm of possibility, and that's almost what makes it even more unsettling because we already share a planet with this species. If I had to describe this book in one word, that word would be elegant. It's exploring how we define consciousness and how we define sentient life in so many different ways from so many different angles, and the way it gradually builds out all of those existential ruminations and arguments is very precise. There's discussions about AI technology, for example, that run parallel to the discovery of this octopus species that ties back into the question of how we define consciousness and how we can even begin to approach that question when we're so deeply biased within our own human condition. Is it even possible for humans to establish contact with or hope to even understand these octopus when the ways that we process thought and language and culture and meaning are all irrevocably rooted in our experience of humanness? Is it possible for us to unorient ourselves from our humanity, to decenter ourselves from our human experience, to truly get inside the minds of these creatures or things that are not humans and don't make sense of the world in the same ways humans do? As the story progresses, these scientists are realizing that maybe the question isn't how are these creatures like us, but rather what can we understand about the world from them? Which is a very subtle shift in perspective, but a really important one nonetheless. Much like the creatures this story focuses on, this book is incredibly unique. It's part moral quandary, part eco-thriller, part treatise on global citizenship and responsibility, and part love letter to the necessity of scientific imagination in so many ways. I will say that there's a lot of monologuing in this book, which makes some sense since a lot of these characters are scientific types who like to theorize out loud, but that does make the dialogue feel unnatural at times, like much more unnatural than fictional dialogue is already intended to be. And the other main thing to keep in mind is that the trajectory of the story more closely resembles a scientific thought experiment as opposed to a traditional plot structure that you might expect. I do also want to point out that for some reason, even though this book is set in the Con Dao Archipelago in Vietnam, the name is printed in the book, at least in my ebook, without accent marks, which I don't understand. You can't just take away accent marks from a regional language and still expect what's left to be the same word. That's not how it works. So in that regard, and also perhaps in some regard to perspective choices, there are definitely some authorial and editorial choices that we can and should interrogate. So take that as you will. It's not a perfect book, but I will definitely be thinking about it for a very long time. If you're even remotely interested, I would absolutely recommend it, and I gave it a very strong 4 stars. So those are all the books I read in July. As always, if you've read any of these yourself, or if you plan to, drop by the comments down below and let me know what you think. But that's everything I had to share for this wrap-up today. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, educate yourself, be kind to yourself, take care of yourself, and I will catch you on the flip side of the page. Bye!